Brothers and sisters in the Dhamma, and my all global citizens, my fellow brothers and sisters, very Jai Bhim to all of you, and Namo Buddhaya. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me to speak few words on the extremely important issue in our times, particularly when we are passing through extremely critical and sensitive phase of humanity in 21st century. And we all are very much aware of that. So I'm very happy to speak on this important subject and important issue regarding caste and race in today's time. And I feel honored to speak before such a responsible and dedicated practitioners, those who are committed their lives for transforming self and transforming the world and society around them. I also wanted to say that I would like to dedicate this talk to those who are still living under terrible oppression because of the various forms of oppression given by the society or culture, or by so-called privileged castes or classes or races, whether they are untouchables, ex-untouchables in India, or my brothers and sister Roma in Hungary, or dark-colored people in the West or in African continent. So I would like to dedicate my talk to them, and also if privileged are suffering, them too. I also wanted to say something at the beginning. I might use the word Dalits or black or white or Brahmin. I no way identify them with any identity, because I don't believe in a caste-based, race-based, or gender-based, or color-based identity. I might just use those words just to transport my message clearly, so that my message is understood well. As Buddha says, we are indeed living in the world on fire. And of course, this corona crisis, the corona pandemic, COVID-19 crisis, shaken the humanity than ever before. All our ways of thinking, the way we see our life has been changed. The way we relate with each other has been changed. But in such situation, this also equalizes the humanity in some ways, if you think deeply, because this virus or suffering we do encounter equally. So it equalizes the humanity in terms of fear of death and life. I wanted to sustain, I wanted to be happy, and I wanted to be safe. So in that sense, whether they are poor or privileged, they all are equalized in this situation. And such situation that shakes humanity deeply brings out the worst and the best out of us, out of our mind, out of our culture, and out of our society. It brings the best and the worst. So, of course, the best part is people are coming forward to support people. People are coming forward to help whatever they could. For example, there are a lot of relief work has been done by Tritna Sangha worldwide, and particularly in India, of course, supported by Western brothers and sisters. But this situation are also bringing, well, I thank for that, but this situation is also bringing the worst in human mind as well. So the hidden tendencies, the hidden prejudices, or the unconscious bias, the condition, the superiority condition of power, that is also coming up like anything in the crisis we are facing. Probably we all are become so much aware of ourselves and we don't know how to handle that. So in the name of security, in the name of identity, in the name of caste, in the name of race, privileged and so on, we are also trying to assert our own life in a sort of worst way or a negative way, where we see the one religion is blind to another. The upper castes are blind to the lower caste. Whites are blind to the blacks. Rich are blind to the poor. Men are blind to women. And the power, the state, sort of blind to the welfare of people, needy people. Probably they are blind to the generosity, blind to the moral governance, moral order of the governance that helps every community, every citizen and every individual in the best possible way. So there are invisible barriers. I would say the structured barriers are at function, are at work. Because that's so much imbibed in our blood, bone and flesh that we are not yet aware of, that we may not yet sort of realize the way I speak, the way I read, the way I behave, the way I deliver statement, how that affects to the other. We see that very clearly in the West. Well, there are reports that most of the CEOs are of big company, multinational company, or vice chancellors or heads are been black. At 2016 Higher Education Statistic Agency published the report that 70% professors in British university are white, and the Department of Education, according to the Department of Education in UK, the black childs are three times are more prone to expel from these schools, and also the situation for dark skin color people and the treatment from police or they are charged by drugs are very harsh. And India especially is very particular situation. What we are experiencing, there is still discrimination, atrocities based on caste. Even in quarantine, people are discriminated. Upper caste refuse to eat the food prepared by so-called lower caste. In quarantine period, even they are dying. A Brahmin asks for a special treatment in quarantine situation. They still, their privileged mind or the upper, so-called upper mind is at active. A Dalit boy, when he was trying to enter into a village, he was shot dead in North India by upper caste people. And there are incidences which we can't even imagine. The naked parade and the lower caste people, especially ex-untouchables, are forced to drink the urine through shoes. So the situation and the images are disturbing and upsetting indeed. And the Tamil Nadu report has been published. There are 50 cases registered in 40 days. Of atrocities on Dalit because of the caste. So indeed, we have to acknowledge, we have to recognize that there is a problem. There is a severe problem. There is a serious problem which needs to address probably than ever before. If at all the technologies and information technologies has grown and the information is very widely sort of shared across the globe and cultures and societies. So in that situation, indeed, we need to sort of address this very important issue, at least being a follower of Dr. Ambedkar and being a Buddhist, even being an order member, I need to sort of look things, not the way world thinks, not the way world addresses or society in general addresses, but as a practitioner, as a person or an individual who is committed to attain a wisdom, what would be my understanding and I to look into to these important and serious issues. Well, there has, if I speak in the frame of Dr. Ambedkar's life, who himself comes from so-called lower and an untouchable background. In 1938, when he was discussing an industrial dispute bill, he made a important sort of provisions that eight hours working in a day, a labor welfare fund or child labor, maternity leave, women's labor welfare fund. He fought for it in his lifetime. And during 1945, World War time, in 7th Labour Conference, Dr. Ambedkar was asking a question to the state. I would decide the welfare of the people on the basis of how many homeless people got a home, how many naked child and girls and people got well clothed, properly clothed, how many hungry men and women got properly nourished and cultivated, and uneducated got education and sick restored to their good health. So during this discussion in World War, while he was discussing with the National Service Tribunal in 1945, Dr. Ambedkar sort of passionately urging that whatever the pressures war has been given to the people, the war must not be used as the occasion for deteriorating the labor's condition and dignity of labors or lower caste or poors in the country. So that today I would like to sort of revitalize the same spirit. This pandemic or the situation we all are in must not be used as an excuse to maintain the power of the privileged, the power of the upper caste or the white privileged, if I use that sort of categorical term, or any privileged in the world. It must be pro people, it must be for all, and must be equalized in terms of sharing economic resources, in terms of sharing job resources, educational resources, whatever state has to provide. But what we see, especially in India, the 81% migrant laborers are now jobless. 90% population among Dalit communities are still serving the manual labor, like cleaning excretas and dirty works, without any health insurance or lack of health insurance. And unemployment rate has been gone up like anything. So the situation is hitting hard to the poors and the so-called lower caste in India. So because of the caste system, the Hindu caste system, it's very difficult to maintain the balance between occupation, caste and social status. That's the Varnashrama Dharma Gandhi advocated in his thinking. And there are a very sort of prominent episode in the great epic in ancient time in Ramayana, on the basis of Varna, how Rama kills the so-called untouchable or the lower caste saint called Shambhuka, is because the certain caste are prescribed to certain occupation, and that therefore their social status because of their birth has been decided. So there is a problem, and therefore with the race and color in the West. So let me move towards what would be the solution. In a very celebrated essay, Dr. Ambedkar argues there is nothing called caste. He's not ignoring the problem of caste. Indeed, he fought in his lifetime for it to equalize the humanity. But he says that there is no physical thing called caste, like a wire or a brick, where it has a color or weigh, you can weigh it. It's a notion of mind. It's your caste sort of notion that is in your mind. And after 20 years reflecting on this issue in Kathmandu, Dr. Ambedkar says that the modern world is in need of Dhamma than ever before. So what is this notion of caste? is nothing but the false reality, the sort of a wrong view that we carry, the innate, probably wrong view, the unconscious view that we carry. The moment we see, we immediately judge people. The moment we see their color, we judge people. And Dr. Ambedkar says that the artificial chopping of the population into fixed and the defined units, that's what it's caste, each prevented from the fusing with the one another. And the characteristic of this caste system, the open door has been closed forever, eternally closed. There is no sort of mobility or the endosmosis among two communities or two caste, and for the preservation of their blood purity or the race purity. That's one of the worst view, a wrong view, probably we all are carrying in our mind in the name of caste or race. But Dr. Ambedkar also says, mind can undo. What you have created, mind can dismantle those false notion of thinking. I myself sort of come from so-called lower caste, but I never ever thought myself in terms of caste and race. I never accepted what has been given from the graded inequal society or from the privileged caste or the class or the race. I never accepted that, and that's precisely because I changed the way of thinking with a great gift that Dr. Ambedkar has given to India, to this community, especially the Buddha Dhamma, Buddha. And that disposition of mind made me a cognitive shift. I started thinking differently. I started thinking, oh, I don't have to sort of recognize with that. Whatever color I belong to, whatever caste I belong to, whatever race I belong to, I don't have to identify myself with that caste or race. Because as Dr. Ambedkar says, there is nothing of that kind in where I have to judge myself. I have to internalize that inferiority in me. Probably I can be much better and brighter than so-called privileged. And on some occasion, I sort of experienced it myself. While I was studying in the top universities, I was studying, well, they speak very smart English. They speak very good English. They are very smart in their presentation, but with a very shallow content, with very shallow and superficial experiences. And because the lack of opportunities, the very bright, profound minds has been marginalized. So you see, so what we need, what sort of Pali Canon evokes in Sanyukta Nikaya, in the Manasikara Sampada Sutta, the disposition of mind, Yoniso Manasikara, the wise attention, I have to correct my view, I have to look at into my view. That's what Dr. Ambedkar's method is. His method is the disposition of mind. In fact, he says the real reform in the world can only bring by reforming your own mind. So that real reform in mind is needed. What happens when I club this race or caste identity with the divinity, and if I internalize that eternal birth or eternal race, there is a problem. I call it a cosmic corruption. When your race and divinity is clubbed by the higher God or the supernatural power, who are humans to change it? I think that's where Buddha departs from all the founders of religion. In fact, Buddha did not found any institutional religion. But what Buddha taught is the Dhamma, the true nature of reality, the right view. That's what he taught. And I don't want to go into detail, but in the life of the Buddha, there is an event on the fifth week of his enlightenment. He encountered a Brahmin called Huhunka Jati under the Ajpala Nigroda tree. And that is the first statement he delivered to the representative of unenlightened world. And what he said? He said, Na jaccha vaslo hoti na jaccha hoti bamano. Kamuna vaslo hoti kamuna hoti bamano. It's not your birth, but your worth that makes you a noble or evil or devil. See? So, there is no divinity that defines the eternal purity or the eternal privileges in your race or community or caste. That is a wrong notion and that's a false reality, which must be challenged than ever before in today's time. So that's what Buddha changed the structure of the society. He altered the way of thinking about the society or an individual or about the world. That's where the genius of Dr. Ambedkar lies. The project of liberation, Dr. Ambedkar pinned down to the Dhamma, pinned down to the true nature of reality. That's what I meant by Dhamma, not in terms of institutional religion. He says that the function of Dhamma is to reconstruct the society and an individual, not in the doctrinal or ideological or communal or even textual tradition. Textual, what I mean here, a sacredity of the text, shastras, what has been written, you must follow that. That fundamentalism of textual tradition, that's what Buddha and Dr. Ambedkar rejected. But he anchored the project of liberation in the true nature of reality. The reality that really sees through the illusion, sees through the ego, sees through the ignorance. To understand what the bright and what is the luminosity of your own mind or reality itself. That's what Dr. Ambedkar advocated. And he, unlike Marx, he says that religion is necessary for society. But slavery, poverty, any form of discrimination or violence is antithesis to the religion. So that religion must be based on love, must be based on equality, must be based on liberty, must be based on fraternity. Let me just come at the last part of my presentation. It was 1956 in Kathmandu, immediately after his public proclamation of being Buddhist and Buddhist conversion from Nagpur, he traveled to Kathmandu. And while he was addressing not to the Dalits, not to the ex-untouchable, not even to Indians, he was addressing to the Buddhist world from Myanmar, from Thailand, Nepal, probably some Chinese or Malaysians. They were in the whirlpool or the loop or the trap of the doctrinal understanding of reality. Of course, they might have good intention, but the ways, the means were not right because they believed in violence. That's where Dr. Ambedkar departed, probably from the all modern social and the spiritual reformers. In fact, Dr. Ambedkar did not believe in reform. Dr. Ambedkar believed in transform, total transformation, not reformation or rearrangement, not this or that. Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, or Shudra, Vaishya, Kshatriya, Brahmin. No arrangement, but total transformation of the arrangement. That's where everyone puts at liberation in equal terms, without any discrimination. And Dr. Ambedkar says in that talk, in fact, he evokes the surest way. And what's that surest way? He says that I want to conquer my enemies by love. I wanted to conquer enemies by non-violence, unlike communists believe. They may get a quick result, but they don't really get a long-term result. One form of oppression has been changed by the another form of oppression. And he says that the Buddha's way is the surest way. It might appear long, it might appear tedious, but that's no doubt the surest way. So maybe that's the spirit of Maitri, the spirit of Metta, loving kindness, Dr. Ambedkar evoked as a solution, as a path to liberation. So Metta always invites to come out of your rigid ego-based, fixed-based self, or your lazy, comfortable zone, or your privileged upper caste throne or chair, where you think that I am ruling. So the problem lies at both the side, and Metta is only a solution. You remember what Bhante has to say, that you cannot solve the problem at the level of the problem. You have to go above the problem. So you have to raise the level of our consciousness, level of our view towards the perfect or right view, wholesome view rather, to resolve the problem. And what happened? There is an inferiority complex that so-called lower caste or black have been internalized, that I can't do it. I call it the inferiority complex, internalizing inferiority complex. I can't do it. I have to prove myself. He or she becomes conscious. When I go to class, how do I teach? How do I speak? How my English will be delivered? How my pronunciation would be heard? Will I be judged from the way I utter my English, and so on and so forth? Again, there is nothing pure about English. There is nothing great about English. It's only a means of communication in that sense. Of course, every language has its own profundity and its beautiful expression. So English has, so Prakrit has, so Pali has, so Marathi has, so Sanskrit has, so Greek has, so Latin has. You see what I mean? So there is no judgment on the basis of race or caste. So I urge my fellow brothers and sisters, let us not internalize that inferiority. On the other hand, there is also internalization of superiority syndrome. What is that superiority syndrome? Might exist in Brahmin or upper caste or white, so-called. Of course, there are exceptional. Not everyone is like that from either side. So they think the people who are internalized or victimized themselves by the superiority syndrome, that I can fix the world. Oh, I have to go and correct the world. Only I can do things right. The patronizing and dominating instinct they have internalized. And it's very pertinent in today's time, how the progressive upper caste in India sort of suddenly change their colors, claiming their superiority or the privileges. So there are problem with this identity, internalizing this identity, where there is no identity, no identity, but continuity. I cannot fix that identity eternally within me, whoever I am. And I have to be aware of these things. I have to be internalized the awareness, the profound awareness called Sati. On the International Convention, there has been discussion about the Satipatthana. So, but the aspect of Sati, aspect of Smriti, which is revolutionary, I wanted to hint at, that if you are aware, you can reclaim the hidden potential within you. Even the negative energy, either in you or outside you or in the world, I can reclaim that potential of enlightenment. I can replace even the pain of inferiority or the oppression, and I can transform that into, or generate that energy into, a positive spirit, a liberative spirit. That's the magic of Sati. I can reclaim that blocked in me for the sake of enlightenment, for the sake of liberation. That's what Buddha did in the Brahmins, Kashyapa or the so-called untouchables called Sunit or the Chandalika Prakrita or the Patachara or people from any community or caste. Buddha sort of reclaimed that blockages in them which they already had, which they already have the seed of enlightenment in their mind. Buddha sort of instigated towards that sati, that smriti in them and put them on the right track. Margadata, showed them a right path. Not give them a liberation, but invited them to come out of their inferiority or superiority and enter into an ocean of Dhamma, enter into an ocean of no identity. On anything, gender, caste, race, white, black, Dalit, untouchables or whatever. Enter into an ocean of luminous mind. So, if I have to correct the cosmic corruption I called, which is clubbing the race and caste with the divinity, I have to invite the cosmic metta, the cosmic sort of energy of metta, of maitri, to bring the equalization in humanity, to create an environment of equality, to unite all humanity for the liberation. That's what it is, it needed. Therefore, Dr. Ambedkar even defines the democracy on the basis of Maitri, liberty, equality, fraternity, anchored in the basis of Maitri. That's the synonym he uses for democracy, with the reverence and respect and with the associated living. So Maitri is the way to accept others, the spirit of inclusivity, the spirit of resolve the problem on the basis of raising the level of consciousness. That's the genius of the masters. That's the genius of the Buddha. That's the genius of Dr. Ambedkar. That's the genius of the Sangha. It's not just vertical, horizontal, but the vertical depth. Realizing that there is no self, realizing that there is no caste or race identity, and I don't have to judge myself on the basis of my skin color, what color I pursue. It's the biological accident, nothing else. I have seen very wise, enlightened black and Dalits. I have also seen the unwise blacks and Dalits. I have also seen the very wise whites and the very unwise whites. Or unwise Brahmin and wise Brahmin. So it's nothing to do with the caste or birth. It's to do with your worth. Lastly, I would like to sum up or conclude with the dream that Buddha saw. The four birds flying from the four different direction in the four different color and coming down and settling at the feet of the Buddha, transforming their color into a luminosity. Color is white, but there is no whiteness as such in terms of categorical white or race called white. The luminosity, limitless luminosity, brightness, that's where the four birds of four color transforms at the feet of the Buddha. That's the dream Buddha had. Probably that's the spirit and that's the solution we have to have and merge into a ocean of compassion, ocean of Dhamma, ocean of humanity. Manuski, the beautiful word Dr. Ambedkar has used, the ocean of humanity, to transform the world and to transform the self. I just wanted to say and leave with certain question. I'm inviting you, how it is to feel when you evoke the spirit of empathy. If we don't act with the equal notion or equality in the society, what kind of civilization and world we are going to inherit or heritage in future, where one caste is pulling towards different down by another caste, where white is oppressing black or upper is oppressing lower, rich is oppressing and so on and so forth. What kind of world we are going to inherit in the future? What kind of human civilization we want? How do you feel when you just internalize yourself, think yourself, how do you feel if you are born in a family where society is stigmatized, where the family is stigmatized by the social prejudices, by the social stigmas, though you may not born in the underprivileged family, how do you feel if you evoke the spirit of empathy or sympathy? Empathy is something impossible to enter into someone's consciousness, but the metta sort of helps us to do that. So how do we feel? How do you interact if your family members are from different caste or different race or different nation? How do you interact with them? You may not intended to act differently, but how do you feel? And if someone from another community or caste or race enter into Buddhist center, what is your immediate response? Yes, you wanted to be friendly, but is there something echoing within your mind? Are you aware of that? Or do you think, oh, I have to patronize by being friendly? Are you genuinely friendly? Are you just trying to be friendly? So I think mark that difference. And lastly, are you really what you thought of? Are you really what you thought of in terms of race, in terms of gender, in terms of caste, in terms of nation? Are you really that? Please ask yourself. If not, if answer is no, if there is no identity of that kind, probably something greater is waiting for you. Probably something far liberative waiting for you. And if that new horizons are waiting for you, please don't stop to go ahead. Please don't kill that possibilities, greater possibilities that might just put you in the liberation forever from the suffering. That's what I would invite you to contemplate on this question. Thank you very much. And that's what I have to say in this presentation. I wish you a very safe stay and all the best and creative time ahead. Jai Bhim, Namo Buddhaya.